In this video, we're going to create a spreadsheet simulation model for a single server queuing system. This is the second model that we're creating for a single server queuing system. The first model that we created previously in a different video, the approach we took for that was to use the rows in the spreadsheet to represent each minute in time. So we simulated each minute in time and used the rows to create that model. In this case, we still have Poisson arrivals and exponential service, so we have an MM1 type system that we're simulating. But in this case, instead of using the rows to represent each simulated minute in time, we're going to use each row to simulate each customer that's entering the system. For this model, we're going to use the same values as we had before for the input variables. We have 10 customers per hour as the arrival rate. And then for the average service time, it's measured in minutes, we had 5 minutes. And just as before, to compute the service rate, this is just a matter of computing 1 divided by the average service time, which is in cell C3. And then from here, what we're going to do is multiply this by 60 to get the service rate in the number of customers per hour, which will be 12, just as we had before. For this model, what we're going to need in as well is the average inter-arrival time, or the time between arrivals. Because we're looking at this for each customer, we need to understand what is the time between arrivals. And recall that to have a Poisson number of arrivals, for example with rate lambda, it's equivalent to having inter-arrival times, so the time between arrivals, to be exponentially distributed with the mean of 1 over that lambda. So that's exactly what we're going to do here. For each customer, we're going to model exponentially distributed inter-arrival times, or time between arrivals. And that is the same thing as modeling the Poisson number of arrivals. So we're going to take that approach here. So we're going to figure out, what is the average inter-arrival time? Well, it's going to be the inverse. So what we'll use is, this is going to be equal to 1 divided by C2, which is the arrival rate. And then we're going to multiply that by 60. And then we will have the average inter-arrival time, which is 6 minutes in this case. Okay, so next what we will do is we'll start to work on this model. First thing we're going to do is we're going to look at the different columns that we have for the simulation model. So for each customer, if we're looking at row 8, we're going to have a random number 1, which is the random number for the arrival process, so that's going to be used to determine the inter-arrival time. Random number 2 is going to be used for the service time. So we have different random numbers, 1 to deal with the arrivals and 1 to deal with service, and they should be separate. And then once we have the inter-arrival time, we'll also need formulas to compute the arrival time for each customer. We'll also need to determine what time the service begins, the amount of time that that customer will be waiting in the queue, the time the service will end for that customer, the time that the customer spends in the system, the amount of time that the server is idle, and the number in queue for each customer. Okay, so let's begin. First thing we're going to do is determine the first random number, and of course that's just a rand function. And then we'll have a different random number function, a rand function for random number 2. And then we can copy these formulas down. Now we're seeing the same value showing up, and now that's because of the cell calculation. I have calculation options set to manual rather than automatic, and so to change to recalculate the cells. I'm in control. I just need to select calculate now. And then we have different random numbers for each customer. Two random numbers for each customers. Each customer, we have one random number, as I said, for the arrival process. And then we have one random number two, which is going to be for the service process. Okay, now let's figure out the inter-arrival time that we're going to use. This is going to be similar to what we've seen before, but of course we're going to be using the exponential distribution, as I mentioned. So it's going to be similar to what we saw for the service process for the other model, but we're going to use also exponential distribution for the inter-arrival times. Okay, so let's go through this. So this inter-arrival time, it's going to be the maximum of 1, because we want to make sure that we have at least 1 minute of time between arrivals. Now we're going to round, make sure that we get a integer value, because the exponential distribution is a continuous distribution. We can't have decimal values returned, and very likely that will happen. So what we want to do is round it to 0 decimal places, so we get an integer. Now, the formula we're going to apply here is similar, as I mentioned, to the one that we'll use for service, but it is different in two ways. And the main thing that's different here is that we're using not the average service time in cell C3, we're using the average inter-arrival time, which is in cell C5. Okay, so that's important. Then we have C5 here, and then we multiply this by ln 1 minus, and then it's going to be a different random number. For this one, we're going to use random number 1, which is in cell C9. So we'll have ln 1 minus C9. And then we're going to have 0 digits to be able to round this to the nearest integer. And then finally, we'll close the brackets on the maximum, just to make sure we have at least 1 minute for our inter-arrival time, so make sure we don't round down to 0. Okay, and with that formula, we'll get the inter-arrival time, or the time between arrivals for each customer, and we can copy this formula down and recalculate cells, and we'll get a different time between arrivals for each customer. Similarly, let's skip over and do the service time formula, because it will be similar to the inter-arrival time formula, and then we'll come back to the arrival time formula in column E shortly. Okay, here what we're going to have, again, is very similar. We're going to do the same max 1 and then round, so we want to make sure that we get at least 1 minute for the service time. And then now, again, we're going to have minus times C, but now it's the service time, so we want C3. Oops. We're going to have C3. We're going to do the average service time, and then that's going to be multiplied by ln times 1 minus, and now, again, we're going to use random number 2, not random number 1, because random number 1 was used for the arrival process, but now we're going to use the random number 2, which is going to be for our service process. So we're going to use, instead we're going to use F9. So there's two differences between the inter-arrival time in minutes formula and the service time in minutes formula. The first thing, of course, is to use the average service time instead of the average inter-arrival time, and then the second thing is to use the random number 2 rather than the random number 1. The rest of the formula is the same. We have the number of digits to be 0, so that we round to the nearest integer. And then that gives our service time in minutes. Now, if we copy that formula down, and then if we recalculate cells, we'll get different service times for each customer. Okay, so now that we have the inter-arrival times, or the time between arrivals, and then we have the service time, in minutes. Now let's work on getting the next part, which will be the arrival time. Now the arrival time is going to be different for the first customer compared to the other customer. So the first customer is just simply equal to the time between arrivals, because there's no customer before customer 1. And then for the next customer and all the future customers, In this case, it's going to be the arrival time of the previous customer plus the time between the arrivals. Okay, that'll give us the arrival time for this customer. And we can copy that formula down and recalculate the cells to see the different times. Okay, now that we have this, we can now start working on the time that the service begins. Okay, the time that the service begins for the first customer is simply the arrival time, just an E9. Now let's come back to get the time service begins for row 10 or for customer 2 in a moment. Let's compute the time service ends for this customer. Well, that's just going to be equal to the time the service begins plus whatever the service time is. So H9 plus G9. And that formula we can copy down because it's always going to be the same. Now that we have this information, we can now construct the time the service begins for the next customer. Well, that's going to be the maximum of the time the service ends for the previous customer and the arrival time for this new customer. So that's going to be the maximum of what we have for J9 from the previous customer, the time the service ends, and the arrival time that this customer will have. And with that formula, we can copy it down from the second customer. Okay, let's work on the other formulas that we have. Okay, let's work on the waiting time in queue. Well, for the very first customer, there's no waiting in the queue. It's an empty system, so that will be zero. Whereas for the next customer, in this case, it's going to be equal to the time that the service begins. And then we subtract the arrival time. That's how long this particular customer waited in the queue. And then we can copy that formula down and calculate. The next formula we can figure out is the time that the customer actually spent in the system. Well, that's just going to be the time in service plus the time that they were waiting in the queue, so the time in the service. The time in service is a G9, that's the service time, plus the time that they're waiting in queue, that's an I9, and it'll be the same thing. Time the customer spends in the system, it's always the time in service plus the time waiting in the queue. So we can copy that down and we can recalculate the cells to find that information out. And then the next thing we should figure out is the server idle time. Well, for the first customer, the arrival time is equal to the time that the service begins. So this implies that the first customer is going to be idle for H9, which is the time the service begins, minus 1. Whereas for the second customer and later customers, this is similar, but it's going to be equal to H10, but not minus 1. Instead, it's going to be minus the time that service ends for the previous customer. So H10 minus J9. H10 minus J9, and then we can copy that down and recalculate. Okay, and the final formula that we need to look at here is the number in queue. Well, for the first customer, it's simply 0. However, for remaining customers, this is a fairly complicated formula. What we're going to do is we're going to use a COUNTIF formula to determine the number in the queue. We're going to start with the time the service is beginning for this particular customer with an absolute reference. And then what we're going to do is make the range go to H10, but we have a relative reference on the H10 portion, so that when we copy this down, it's going to look at all of the customers from the beginning of the system. And what we're going to do is to figure out whether or not we're going to count them as somebody in the queue, and that's going to depend on if this number at the time service begins, is it larger than the value that we have in the arrival time? If it is, which is E10, then we have efficient waiting. So let's go and correct that. So we're going to have E10. Okay, so that's what we're going to compare. And for any case that it is, then we're going to count them. So what we're seeing is on the H9 to H10, is the time, we're going to look at time service begins. And is the range, that's the range for all customers up to customer, you hit the customer in that row I, in this case, in that row 10 for customer 2. And then E10 is the arrival time. And what we're doing here is we're saying for each customer who arrived before the customer did in row I, in row 10 in this case, if the service begins is after the arrival time for the customer in row I, for row 10, it means that that customer was waiting in the queue when this customer in row I, or in row 10 in this case, arrived. Okay, so that is how we're going to construct this, and then we can copy this formula down. And as we recalculate, we'll see that the number in queue is calculated accordingly. If we, let's just recalculate it again, times. And as we go down, what we'll see is this formula is going to be changing. As I mentioned, it's a relative reference on the second part, like in this case H9 to H24. So we're going to look at all of the customers up to that point to determine if in fact they are waiting in the queue at the time when the customer, in this case 16, arrives. Okay, that will be the end of this video. We didn't compute the simulation results, the output formulas, and the reason for that is because those formulas are formulas that we won't need to consider for the midterm exam that's coming up soon. But the other formulas, it's worth reviewing from this model, and then also from the single server queuing system model number one that we did, where we had rows to represent each minute in time, of course, as well as many of the other examples that we saw in this class, along with other problems that we saw before. So I hope this video was helpful and you enjoyed learning about building the single server queuing system model for the spreadsheet simulation model, where we're looking at using rows for each customer.